name is Andres Ortega. I'm the invertebrate ecologist here with the district. And today we have Brittany Buckles. She comes from the Fish and Wildlife Service, and she'll be leading the workshop today. So before I hand it off to her, I do just want to say a couple things. So most of us, not necessarily all of us, but most of us are probably here because they're planning on participating on our Bee Blitz on Monday. At this point, anyone, both staff and volunteers that are planning on attending, should have gotten an email with the time, location, just a general event information. If you have not gotten that for some reason, please see me immediately after the workshop and we can get that to you. For those people, keep in mind that we are still right now planning on having our Blitz on Monday. There is some inclement weather on the forecast, and so we're just kind of riding the fence right now, and it's 50-50 whether we will continue to have it on Monday or if we're going to have to go with the rain date of August 15th. So what I would recommend is that I will make that decision no later than Sunday afternoon. So by Sunday evening, no later than Monday morning, I would recommend checking your email before you head out to Blackwell and see if it's been postponed until the 15th. Okay? And again, if you have no idea what I'm talking about, if you don't know any of the details for the Blitz, by all means, just see me after the workshop. And so we wanted to have Brittany come out partially for the Bee Blitz. It is good to have some general background info on bees, common bees in the area, how to identify them, especially how to take good pictures so that you can identify them, and then just even more background like what the service does for their own survey protocol. And that will help the day of the Blitz, but honestly, I think that's just going to be beneficial information in general. It's not information that's just for one day or for one event, but if you're at all interested in bees, identification, bee conservation, I really think this workshop is going to be beneficial to all of us. Okay? Let's see, the only other thing, I know that anyone signed up for the Blitz probably is very curious about exactly what we'll be doing that day. And so we won't cover that today, but either Monday morning or the morning of the 15th, that first hour of the day, give or take, is just going to be me giving a very straightforward presentation of exactly where we're going, what we're doing, how we're doing it, and how to manage those photos. So all of the Bee Blitz specific information will be given to you the morning of the Blitz. And frankly, it's very straightforward, and so I think that's more than enough time to be able to go out to the field that day and know what you're doing and to be able to do it well. So that won't be covered today. But if you have any other questions, again, see me immediately after the workshop and I'll answer them to the best of my ability. And then we should wrap up right around noon today, give or take. If you need refreshments, we have them. If you need the bathroom, just go straight out this door and then to the left, you'll find the restrooms. And that's all I have right now, so I will hand it off to Brittany.
Hi, thank you so much for coming out today to learn about bees, and specifically the rusty patch bumblebee. I think I'm going to sit over here, if that would be okay. Okay, how's my mic? Everything good? Alright, so my name's Brittany Buckles. I'm with the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service on this Rusty Patch Bumblebee project. And I'm really excited to be here today because the Rusty Patch Bumblebee is listed as endangered. and we're working really hard to protect it and conserve it by first monitoring where it's located. This area has ideal habitat for the Rusty Patch Bumblebee. So we're really excited to be here today to talk about the Rusty Patch and how to identify it and what it needs. So hopefully during your Bee Blitz, someone will spot it. That would be really exciting. Even if you don't spot it though, we want to know where the bee is and also where it's not, so we can follow population trends. So I think this would be a great place, Andres, if you're interested, in initiating some long-term monitoring plans just to keep your eye on the area for the bumblebee. So my name is Brittany Buckles. I'm with the U.S. Fish and Wildlife for the project. And I'm an entomologist. I have a master's degree in entomology from the University of Illinois, and I've worked with a lot of fun organizations like Naperville Park District, which is right around the corner, and the Field Museum, and some other places around Chicago. So I'm happy to be here to talk to you about the Rusty Patch Bumblebee today. One thing I want to mention before we start is during this presentation I have a lot of photographs of bees. So here's one. Most of them are the Rusty Patch Bumblebee. This will give you a good idea of what photos are identifiable, because all of these photos were taken directly from BeeSpotter, a website designed by the University of Illinois in Urbana-Champaign. I'll talk to you more about that later. And these were taken by a range of different people that have cameras that saw the bee, took the picture, uploaded it to the database at BeeSpotter, and then an entomologist working there identified it to species. So these are rusty patch bumblebees that were identified the way that I'm going to try to teach you how to do it for your bee blitz or for other monitoring purposes. So notice how this picture includes the flower. You can see the markings of the bee, especially on that upper part of the abdomen, and it's not blurry. So it's really difficult to get good pictures of bees, so today I'm going to introduce you a little bit of how to do that. We're going to talk about the biology of the bee, some identification skills, protocols and handling methods, and then I will introduce to you this website, BeeSpotter, the database we're using to collect the photos. And then we'll get a little field practice today. So when we're done with this, hopefully you can go out and take some pictures of the bees, bring it back, use the key I'm giving you, and be able to identify the bee to species based off your photo. So I'll talk a little bit more about why that's so rare and exciting in a minute. So some things about the biology of the bee. There are 20,000 species of bees globally. There's about 500 of them in Illinois. And Chicago has a very wide diversity of bees. Even in the urban ecological system, it can really be a great place for bees to get their resources and survive. For example, the endangered rusty patch bumblebee. So for the conservation management guidelines, I'll talk a little bit about creating, enhancing, and maintaining the foraging and nesting locations. So when you think about the bee and how to protect it, you really need to get down on the level of the insects. So the bee needs not only foraging resources, but places to nest too. So those are the two things to think about in terms of conservation. They also need an overwintering habitat. So they don't just need a specific plant. Like, they need diversity of plants. They need an environment that is close to a place where they can nest. Most of them are nesting underground. Actually, most bees in general nest underground, about 80 species. So today I brought this bumblebee nest. It's not the rusty patch bumblebee. It's probably Bombus impatiens, the common one. And this was dug out of the ground, and this is what it looks like. So if you want to pass it around and look at it, you can. This one's a little bit crumbled up because I take it places to show people. Usually it's more whole, but this will give you a good idea of where the bees are living. So certain things like prescribed burns, haying, mowing, and grazing can affect bees and their populations. That's what I was looking at in my thesis at U of I, and the same applies for bumblebees. Pesticide use is affecting the species of bees a lot too. So I'll talk about this in a minute, but just a general thought is most of the bees started to decline as the habitat was getting smaller, the fragmentation was increasing, and the habitat was degrading. And a lot of the bees' population started going down at that point. And we are in a global pollinator decline right now. So it's not just one species that's in trouble. Like, the pollinator species are all in the decline. So the interesting thing about the bumblebees is we had data before and after the introduction to pesticide, and it seems like, unlike the general trends of most bees that are declining as the area is decreasing for their ideal habitat, this one decreased afterwards when the introduction of pesticides came about. So that's not necessarily saying that is what caused it, but it's probably a factor in there somewhere. Other things that can harm the bumblebees that should be considered during conservation management is commercial bumblebees and honeybees. So I'm actually also a beekeeper. I have a lot of hives around Chicago, mostly in the south side. And one thing that you need to think about with the conservation of this species is if it's having a problem, if it's the one in trouble, you don't want to put honeybee hives that can damage their likelihood of survival. Can anyone think of a reason or two why maybe putting managed bees in an area where there's one that needs protection could turn into a problem?
Competition for the nectar?
Yeah, so if the habitat, if it's already struggling in the habitat and you bring out managed honeybees, a healthy hive has 40,000 bees in it, so you'll learn later that the bumblebee colonies are much smaller, so competition could be present. There's a lot of literature right now discussing this and trying to figure out where exactly the lines are, but the Fish and Wildlife Service is recommending in areas considered as high potential zones that you don't put new honeybee hives there. And the director at Loyola of Ecology, I think, just recently removed the honeybees from the campus because they found the rusty patch bumblebee there. So it is something to consider that maybe you wouldn't think of right away. Can someone think of another issue that they would have with another negative impact that managed colonies and bumblebee colonies that are commercial could negatively impact the endangered bee? Yeah.
Introduce disease.
Yeah, so honeybees have like different viruses and bacteria and even little mites that they could transfer to a bee that's suffering. So it's not just providing excellent habitat, it's also thinking about aspects of the bee's life, like ideal nesting sites and how they're going to get sick potentially and things like that. Alright, so here's your introduction to Bombus affinis. That's the scientific name for the rusty patch bumblebee, the endangered one, the one that we're all gathered here to learn about. It nests in urban areas, surprisingly, but also that's really cool because it goes in to show you that urban ecology is really important, especially land in Chicagoland, especially habitat within the Chicagoland region for this specific species. So that unlike the honeybees, which have 40,000 in their hive, this endangered species only has 20 in her colony. Sorry, 200. 200 or more workers in her colony. So you can imagine, you know, it's a lot different life. The different species of bees act differently and pollinate differently, overwinter differently. Most bumblebees, actually only the queen will overwinter and the rest of the workers will die off, and then she'll start again fresh. Also, a lot of times the first batch of eggs, those adults are smaller than the last batch and they'll increase in size, which is kind of interesting. So these queens will appear as early as April and they'll last until late summer. According to BeeSpotter, they're preferring willow, plum, and apple, but we do have a guide on the Fish and Wildlife website that you can look at. So all the information that I've gotten from here is mostly from BeeSpotter and the Fish and Wildlife website, and I'm encouraging all of you to visit both platforms because there's a lot of great information, not only about the biology, but if you have a specific question about something that I say, chances are there's a document there that dives deeper into it. So if you want to enhance your land for the bee, you can look at the Xerces Society has a really nice pamphlet on our website. If you want to know what flowers they prefer, there's a pamphlet on their website. So I didn't bring a big packet for you, but you can go online and hit on what you are most interested in. So if you wanted to actually like have long-term monitoring, you want to look at the specific guidelines in the protocol, you can go to the website and look at those as well. So we're just going to hit on a lot of different topics, but you can delve deeper into the areas that you're interested in later on in your free time. Also, it says the males prefer horse mint, goldenrod, sweet clover, and aster, and workers prefer sweet clover and mint. And I think that was from BeeSpotter data. At least that was what's on their website. So as we know, it's listed as endangered now. That's why we're so concerned about it. It was enlisted January 11, 2007 here in the US. And then this bee is an example of an animal that lives both here and in Canada. And it was listed as endangered there too in 2012 in the Species at Risk Act. So about 20 years ago, this bee was abundant. So we have data on the bee before the decline and after the decline, and now we're trying to pick up more data now to watch its progress and monitor where it's at. So originally, 20 years ago, I guess not originally, but 20 years ago, it was in 28 states, and it had a dramatic and swift decline of about 90%. So they took a really big hit. Now they're mostly located in isolated places. They're in about 13 states in 2000. In 2007, they're in about 10, and it's about the same now. So we need to help the bee get back to where it was, figure out what happened, and try to reverse it, maybe. But the first step is finding out where it's located so we can protect those lands. And where it's not, too. It's just as important. So the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service were the ones to list it as endangered. This bee needs really high quality foraging resources. Where we've been finding it isn't usually in someone's backyard. Sometimes it is, but mostly it's in habitat that is really high quality. So that's why I'm here today to talk to you guys, because we are located in the Forest Preserve District of DuPage County on some of the best habitat for the bee in the land. So I'm hoping that if it's not using it now, eventually it will find its way here. And I'll show you a map later where it's been spotted, and you can see it's really close. So this bee needs protection from the pesticides, from the introduced diseases, and other disturbances. This is Louise Clemency, and she was the one that pointed out in the Chicago Tribune, I think, that the decline trend correlates with the introduction of pesticides for agriculture and things like that. So we don't only want to know where the bee is, but also where it is not, so we can protect it. So the main point for conservation, I think, is for land managers to be aware of the bee so we can find out where it is and then implement strategies to preserve the place where the bee is living, because it's really important. If it's supporting this endangered bee, it's probably so good that, you know, other things are being supported too, which is always the great thing. Everything's connected. So even though we're focusing on the rusty patch, it's really a network of species that strive. So this is just a little bit about the rusty patch bumblebee habitat assessment form and guide produced by the Xerces Society, which is located on our website if you're interested and learning more about how to enhance the area that you guys work on. Okay, so now is the fun part. We're doing identification. So first I wanted to show you what are not bees. So I have these out for you guys. Everybody gets one. You can take notes on it. They're yours. Take it out to the field with you. So the purpose is not to teach you about these identification, and then you run out into the field, you look at the bee, and you automatically know, oh, that's Bombus bimaculatus. The point is to get you aware and comfortable enough to take photos that you can upload it to a database and identify it so that we can get data from people who are interested in taking pictures. So if you can take a picture and bring it back, and with the knowledge that I've taught you, identify the bee species, you will then know that's what it takes to take an identifiable photo so that we can get records of this endangered bee. And it's not that we just care about the rusty patch bumblebee, because a lot of times the network of the other bees involved in the ecology allow it to succeed, or, you know, we want to see those trends just to see what happens as the community structure changes. So these bees that aren't the rusty patch bumblebee might be important to report as well. Hopefully there's enough for everyone. All right, so these are not bees. So most of you probably know a little bit about the stuff that I'm going to talk about, but I'll tell you as a beekeeper, actually, that the majority of society does not know the difference between a yellow jacket and a bee. They're all the same to the general public. I know that most of you do know that, but these are not what we're interested in. We're not interested in the yellow jackets or the paper wasps or the mud daubers. We're looking at specifically bumblebees for this project. These are some bees that aren't bumblebees but are still bees. So Bee Spotter will actually take pictures of the honeybee, but Fish and Wildlife Service isn't necessarily interested in it. But maybe it is worthwhile to take data on the honeybees so that you can see how they fit into that community structure too. So just one thing to be aware of, Bee Spotter does take your honeybee pictures, so don't delete them if you want to take. It's up to Andres, really, what he decides. But I'm wondering, does anybody know what one way to tell the difference between a carpenter bee and a bumblebee is? They're both really large and fuzzy. kind of like big, robust bees, but there's one difference. Yeah.
The carpenter bees have a smooth, shiny abdomen,
yeah,
and the
And the bumblebees?
Fuzzy.
Yeah. So see this big, huge abdomen that this carpenter bee has? This is the biggest bee that you'll see in Illinois. There's only one species of them around here, and they're gigantic. The back of the abdomen is completely bald and shiny. So we are not interested in the carpenter bees. These are the ones that people ask me every single time, how do I kill the carpenter bees that are drilling into my shed, you know? These are not bumblebees. They're mostly, they're solitary, unlike the bumblebees. They're complete, their behavior, their nesting, everything's different, but they do look alike, so people get a little confused. So if you see a bald, shiny abdomen like this one, it's a carpenter bee, and we're not that interested in them for this purpose. But if you ever don't know for sure if it is or isn't, might as well upload it, and they'll tell you that it's not. So now on to the bumblebees. Did everybody get one? No? Okay, cool. So you can look with a friend and take notes on a different paper. Sorry, does anyone need a paper to take notes on? Because I have blank papers. No? Okay. All right, so this sheet was from BeeSpotter. So on there, I like have a little source BeeSpotter on there. I think what happened was the graduate students could create something for BeeSpotter that filled a certain requirement for the class. So I went to grad school at U of I too, so I'm aware of this. And that was one of the projects that a grad student did. So it's all correct, and in my opinion, it's one of the most easy keys to read because one of the most beautiful things about researching bumblebees and collecting data through citizen science for bumblebees is compared to all the other natives, these ones are pretty easy to identify in terms of color pattern. So that's really cool because if you've ever identified a bee species under a microscope, it gets really, really tedious. Has anyone done that before? Has anyone identified a bee species under a microscope? So for my thesis, I had to do like, 1,600 bees, and you have to look at like specific, and we'll get into it, I think, the next slide. Here are some vocabulary to learn before you identify an insect species under a microscope. You need to know things like what the vertex, dorsum, pleura, scutellum, pterygoids, posterior margin, all of these different things, so that when the key talks about it, you know what to look at. Not only do you need to know the terminology, but you have to see what a rough one looks like and what a smooth one looks like. Otherwise, you have no idea how to get that animal to species. The cool thing is, instead of doing all that taxonomy terminology work with the key, we can take a picture of a bumblebee because the species diversification has a correlating color pattern. So as you can see on your keys, it's not that they just have one. Some species have five or six, some have two. But depending on if it's a worker, a male, or a queen, the bee usually takes form in certain color patterns. So that's what we're going to use instead of all this complicated terminology. So this is Bombus affinis. This is the endangered one. So by the end of this, I hope that you can recognize the color pattern. So if you take a picture of it or you see it, you'll know. If you take a picture of it, you'll know how to identify it. But if you see it, you'll know to take the picture, because this is really important to get that data. So we have bumblebees here. Obviously, this is focused on the color pattern. Do you see how there's stripes on the abdomen? Those are called pterygoids. So we're going to be focusing on pterygoid 1 and pterygoid 2. But each stripe is pterygoid 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, all the way down. And another thing that we're going to be looking at is what's called a tuft. And the tuft is located on the back of the neck of the bee. So if I was the bee, it'd be like here at the base of my head. And you can see up here on the projector, the last two, the males, are kind of like a goldish color. And then the other ones are black. You need really good eyesight to see this. It's so tiny. I'm sorry if you can't. But sometimes that little tiny tuft is important for identification. So I have an example straight from BeeSpotter, word for word, about if you made it in the key and you have the specimen and you got to the queen, this is something that would be said, and I put this here so that we can appreciate it, how wonderful it is to be able to identify a bee species by its color pattern. So it says, the queen, the face is black with a few yellow hairs intermixed between and above the base of the antenna. Vertex with yellow and black hairs intermixed. The dorsum of the thorax entirely covered with yellow hairs except for a noticeable bare spot on the disc margin by a few scattered black hairs. The pleura is covered with yellow hairs, two bases of the legs, scutellum entirely yellow. Abdomen with triggers 1 and 2 yellow, the posterior and on. So you really have to like take a lot of time and effort to identify most of these species, and it's necessary for certain publications and certain analysis to get the animal to species, or you lose some type of like value behind your data. So this is really important, especially for rusty patch bumblebee monitoring and identification, because there are a few bees that do look similar, but you can be able to tell the difference of species just based on color pattern for the most part. So here's some examples of the worker too, just because this is the bee of concern. It's really detailed stuff. But we're not going to worry about that today. So again, the most important part are these little tufts at the top and the trigger guide 1 and 2. Everyone understand what a tour guide is? The divisions of the abdomen are the stripes. Okay, so now I'm going to introduce to you the common and abundant bee species that you'll see here. These are of Illinois, so it's not going to be exactly correct for this DuPage County, this specific region, but it'll be about the same. So the abundant and common species of Illinois are Bombus impatiens, Bombus pennsylvanicus, Bombus bimaculatus, Bombus grisiocolis, and Bombus vagus. So if you prefer the common names are not included on your handout that I gave you. So you can write them in if it makes you feel more comfortable to call them the Eastern bumblebee, the American bumblebee, the two-spotted, brown-belted, and the half-black bumblebee. So when you're saying scientific names, you can put the emphasis on the third vowel. So this would be grisiocolis, and this would be bimaculatus. So the first one is Bombus impatiens. Raise your hand if you've heard of Bombus impatiens before today. Okay, so this is the most common bumblebee species. It has, so what do you notice about the tour guides that make it pretty easy to identify just by looking at it?
Solid colors.
What?
Solid color.
The which one? What tour guide?
Oh, well, the first one and then the last seven are all solid.
So the very first tour guide is all the way yellow and the rest of the abdomen is completely black. So if you guys go outside and you see this bee foraging, eating on your milkweed or your Monarda fistula outside, you'll be able to say, okay, that first tergite is completely yellow, the rest is black, so it's Bombus impatiens. And you'll be able to identify the species now. Even though most of you hadn't heard of it before entering the room, now you can confidently identify the species when you're looking at the flowers in the park, in the forest preserve, or whatever you're doing that day. So also notice how these pictures are from two different angles, but they were both able, through BeeSpotter, to be identified as species because we can see that identifiable trait within the color patterns. What you can is the first tour guide being completely yellow and then the next one being completely black. So some information about Bombus impatiens. Again, that's the nest that you saw. Did the nest make it all the way down?
Yep, I got
Perfect. So this one's abundant. It has absence of yellow on the second tour guide. It's black completely. And the nesting occurs underground. Usually it's up to 450 workers, so this is pretty large for comparably with the other native bumblebees. So it does really well here in Illinois. This is Bombus pennsylvanicus. So what does the Q stand for? What's the W? And M?
Male.
The male. Okay, so depending on the cast of the bee, the color pattern options. So see this beautiful bee, you can see the side of it. Even though this isn't the best picture because you can't see the whole back side of the tergite, you can see enough of it. On tergite 1, do you see on the picture how it's mostly black and then there's a little yellow on it? Those are those black things, if I was a bee, that are like on her hips on tergite 1. So that picture is identifiable to species because you saw that characteristic. So. I don't have a pointer, but do you see on tergite 1 of this worker the black part on the side? That's really important for identification of this specific species. So this is the American bumblebee, and it's also abundant. I think I saw one out there on my walk-in. So I think we can get some pictures of Pennsylvania bees today. This one is bimaculatus. Does anyone know what bimaculatus means in Latin?
Two spots.
Yeah, this is the two-spotted bumblebee. So what two spots are they referring to? On Turgite 2, see how the yellow kind of like dips in the middle and the outside there's like not really spots, but black spots on the outside of the yellow. So if you see a picture of this bee compared to this one, you'll notice that the black spot's kind of up on the hip of this one, and the black spot is on Turgite 2 of this one. So if you see this bee out there, and it looks like it's missing part of the yellow on each side of the second Turgite 2, and again, Turgites are the stripes in the abdomen, you'll know that this is Bombus bimaculatus. And they're probably out there today too. So again, it's the two-spotted bumblebee, they're common. That's a great picture, right? With the wings out, you can see the turgite's really nice. It's hard to get these perfect pictures, but with practice, and if you know, first you have to know what you're aiming for, and then you have to practice, but I believe everybody here can do it. If you put your mind to it. So this one is the one that people get excited about, and they think it's a rusty patch bumblebee, and the sad part is these are really common. So they're everywhere, and that's good for them, but it's not the rusty patch. So what is the one thing that confuses people, do you think? Anyone want to raise their hand? Okay, go ahead, what?
The rusty patch.
So there is actually a rusty patch. The brown belt is actually a rusty patch on that bee. I mean, just to be like very casual about it, but what do you see that's different with the rusty patch bumblebee?
Not surrounded by yellow.
Yes, completely surrounded. There's a whole section of hair underneath the rusty patch that's yellow. So the Bombus grisiocolus is very common. I think we'll see them today. You guys will probably see it when we go back out for the bee blitz. So if you see the bee and it's obvious that there's no yellow under that rusty patch, then it's the brown belt tissue. This one's common. It nests in dry situations above the ground. So usually bumblebees are under, but this one is above. And it has fewer workers than 50. So they're really small even though they're doing great here. And they're pretty aggressive compared to other ones. But that's not to say outside of the nest. Mostly just like if you visit the nest, they'll be aggressive. If they're out eating a flower, it's a completely different story. And we'll talk a little bit about that later.
I have a little question.
Sure.
If it nests in dry situations above the ground, would you characterize its nesting situations in like dry hill prairies? I mean, is there some kind of ecotype that it nests in versus another?
That would probably be more suitable for this bee compared to another one. I'm not real familiar with where exactly it prefers it to nest, but I've gotten calls before about these bees in garages, like making nests like in old rodent holes that are above the ground. So I think they try to stay dry. Like above, so even if the ground's a little bit wet, they'll still like manage to survive above the ground in dry situations. But that's a good question. One cool thing on the Bee Spotter is you can click a link and it says meet the bees. And every single species I'm talking about today, I think except for the last one, the Rufocinctus, they have a link. And you can go in there and learn very specific things about the bee in terms of its behavior and its nesting and what it prefers to eat in more detail than I could get into today. So if you are really curious about one of these bees or all of them, you can go there and read their bios on Bee Spotter. And it's kind of fun to see the differences between the species even though they're on the same genus. So here is Vegans. Anybody notice something that could become a problem?
Queens, same.
Uh-oh, same color pattern, right? What's the difference? Anybody see it?
One.
Yeah, the tuft. Can you believe it? So as tedious and as terrible as this sounds, this is still so much better than looking under the microscope and seeing if it's ridged or flat or this or that. But it is kind of interesting. The color pattern is true, the tufts are different, but there's also a few other differences. The Vegan's Queen is more, I call it curly haired. Her fuzzies are more, less managed. Like when you look at a rusty patch bumblebee, it looks like a vegan's with a haircut, kind of. And I'll show you, that's just very personifying the bumblebee. But when you see a picture of it, you'll be able to understand what I mean. It's just a little bit more scruffy looking. And the emergence time of the queens are different. So if you get a picture of a queen early on, it's probably the rusty patch because the vegans comes out later. So again, it's that tuft and that top. Also, it's much smaller, so there are differences, but when you're looking at pictures, you know, sometimes it's hard to compare when you don't have the two next to each other. So here's vegans. Can you, just by remembering the pictures of the rusty patch that you've seen in this presentation, and then you look at vegans, you can see how it's a little bit more like curly haired, a little bit less managed in its style, or I think they call it shaggy hair. And you see the tuft on the bee at the top on this picture? What color is it? So again, the queen vegans can be confused with those of the effinus. But vegans has long shaggy hair, it's much smaller, and it appears later in May. They nest below the ground and they have about 70 workers. And again, these bees are really common. So this picture looks different, right? But sometimes it's difficult to see in other photos. These are considered uncommon and rare in Illinois, but that's not to say that they're not going to be common here in DuPage County. So sorry, I should have tailored it a little bit, because I think the orchomis is probably pretty common around here. We'll find out probably by the end of the bee blitz if that's true or not, but that's my guess. So we got orchomis, fervidus, fraternus, and then two cuckoo bees. So those are the black and gold bumblebee, the yellow bumblebee, and we'll see fervidus here too, I'm almost certain. And then the southern plains bumblebee. So the southern plains, I think we're not gonna see that here. I'd be very surprised if we did. But I'm pretty sure the fervidus and the orchomis are gonna be around here. So we'll see what your results are with your bee blitz, but that's what I'm thinking. So there's also two cuckoo bees. So cuckoo bees are not so exciting because they're terrible pollinators to the point where they lack the structure to even do the work. But they're also exciting because if you see a cuckoo bee, that means that your community structure is strong enough to support the parasite. So it goes hand in hand. So we'll talk a little bit about that, but it's not really our focus. So here's our comus. It's huge. It's very big, beautiful bee. If you see it, it just looks different to me. And the color pattern is much different. Now most of the workers and the queens, what's going on with Turgite 1? It's all the way black, so that's new. The other bees have that. So if you see that, it's a good candidate. The queen lays a little bit different. She has she lays each egg into a separate cell, rather in batches, so more like a honeybee, which is, you know, something small, but it's also interesting to learn their differences. They only have about 35 workers, so much smaller compared to Bombus and Patience, which have 450. And then moving along to Fervidus, this one's gorgeous, right? When you see this bee, you'll probably know what it is too. The abdomen is almost completely covered in bright yellow. So it sticks out when you see it. The common name is the yellow bumblebee. It's considered uncommon in Illinois, but again, I'm for sure in DuPage County, it'll be around here. There's 100 to 200 workers in its colony, and this one can be aggressive. This is the only bumblebee that's ever stung me before, but I went to the nest and tried to identify her there. which most bumblebees would be okay with, but Fervidus was not. Their venom is much stronger than honeybee's venom, but it wasn't the end of the world. Like, I got a little red, but I wouldn't necessarily be scared that bees are going to sting you when they're eating flowers, but I'll talk about that in a little bit. Okay, then we got Fraternus. This is the one I don't think we'll be seeing here, but I wanted to include it since it's on your guide. Very distinctive looking bee. The fur, the hair is a little bit different than the other one. It's large. This is a Southern Plains bumblebee. It's rare in Illinois, and its distribution is very southern. Here are some cuckoo bees. So these bees lack the pollen-carrying structure. the Calathea basket is gone in these species because they're not doing work. What they're doing is, they don't even have great hair for collecting pollen. Like even the hair on the bee looks different because her lifestyle is different than the other ones. What she does is finds another bumblebee's colony, like the one that I passed around. She kills all of the eggs in there and the larva. And then she lays her own eggs in the cell. And then her eggs that are in the cells are taken care of by the true queen's real daughters. And the true queen's pheromones change, and she can't lay anymore, and the whole colony dies, and then her eggs survive and to go do the other thing. So it reminds me a little bit of the cuckoo birds. Yeah. So that colony eventually dies. So when you, it's kind of interesting because when you see these, you know that they're like the problem in society, I guess. But also, if you see them, then it's a strong enough population, the healthy ones, that they're able to survive. So it's a good indicator of ecological success, I guess, in one way or another. This one was not included on the page, but we found it before, and I got an email with it a few days ago from Ayala. I think this was the bee that you sent me. But this is the red-belted bumblebee. It's not included on the guide, so if you do want to make a note, these aren't 100% all the bees in Illinois, but they're the common ones. I think this one should be included too. I wonder if we'll find it today or on Monday. It would be cool if we did. The picture got messed up a little bit, sorry. But has already been spotted. Has already been spotted this season.
Yeah, I think it was in Kane County.
Yeah, and it was in Kane County. Great. So I'm going to switch gears now. So I think you would be able to take a photo in the field, bring it back. If you could see the tour guides and you had your guide with you, do you guys feel comfortable that maybe you could get it to species with that information? Awesome. So the objectives of this Fish and Wildlife Protocol are to find and document the new locations, but also reevaluate the previously documented locations and monitor the bumblebees to determine the trends. So maybe we don't find this bumblebee on Monday, but I think this is a perfect area to initiate some long-term monitoring and just to keep your eye on the ideal habitat to see when they enter into it. Because hopefully we'll be able to boost the populations well enough that they'll start spreading in areas they're not. But we'll see what happens. First of all, we need to know what's going on now so we can follow the trends later. So one important thing, if you're interested in following some of these Fish and Wildlife protocols, is to determine which potential zone your location is in. So we have a map on the Fish and Wildlife Service website, and you can enter your location and it'll tell you. And then based off that zone, which is linked to data, we'll give you specific protocol recommendations. There's also, if you want to take it a step further, there's also a habitat assessment guide. Again, that one's by the Xerces Society, but that would be giving you specific ideas to improve your lands. That's for managers. But even if you have a garden in your residency, I feel like residents can read that and see what species they're using, you know, and kind of tailor it to a smaller scale. So it might be interesting for the homeowner as well. So this is our location right now. This building here. So as you can see, it's in yellow, and then there's some red zones around it. So the red zones are the high potential zone. Those are the ones that Fish and Wildlife Service are regulating. And then the low potential zones, it's considered unlikely, but it's like ideal location for the trends to change. So it's not saying that it can't be here. Like I feel like in the low potential zones, we need to do monitoring too. So this is really exciting. It's a great location to be in, and the habitat is ideal. So those two things together are looking good. So these low potential zones are considered additional sites to support the recovery. They're needed to prevent extinction. Like if the bee stays where it is and only where it is, it could be a big problem. So the rusty patch bumblebee may be found in some of the areas based off the dispersal distances for the closely related species. So if you wanted to do, so there's two different, what's this next slide? Yeah. So I mentioned the scientific recovery permit here. This next slide shows you the chart for the zone, the purpose, the recommended protocol, and some effort. So if you're in the low potential zone, which we are here, you can do two, we are recommending two different types of monitoring. One is this one that we're talking about now with taking pictures, and I'll tell you a little bit where to download them to, and then Andres is going to host this B-Blitz on Monday if it doesn't rain. And that would be considered this document, the bumblebee presence without handling the bee. So that will be the photo only. So do you need the permit for that? No. And how much effort do we want to put in? It's really at your discretion. So Andres is going to run through all the details with you. It's not going to be like person A, person B, and person C all have to monitor for 15 minutes and stop your stopwatch and don't enter this zone and walk this transect. It's going to be completely, the effort is completely at your discretion. So this is really cool because we can monitor for the bees completely at our discretion, and we can identify two species with color pattern. So those two things make for a great citizen scientist project. So I'm really happy to be here with a group of people that's going to make that happen. So congratulations on that and good luck. And I'll be here for the Bee Blitz to help you if it's on Monday, so I'm looking forward to that. If you wanted to do a more long-term recovery, which I would suggest, you could look at the bumblebee community and population monitoring. So that includes all the different species of bumblebees, not just the Bombus affinis. You will need a recovery permit for that. So I would apply sooner than later because the process takes a really long time. So it would probably be for next year if you're applying this year. And if you need help with that, Christopher Law at the office in Chicago has offered assistance. So Andres, feel free to reach out to Chris if you need any additional assistance with that. This is more specific. So you'll need one person per hour for 3 acres of the best habitat, and you're gonna have to look through the protocol online for more specific things. But this one is more like scientific based. We can put data into the system for analysis. So there's efforts in all different directions here. We wanna know where the bee is. So if that means sending people out and going to explore and taking pictures and seeing what bees are there, that's great. And that's the purpose of our event on Monday. So I hope to see all of you there. Anyone who's considering going on Monday? All right, most of you, great. Because by the end of this, you'll be considered the trained ones that will have a better idea of how to take the pictures and get the data. So this will be really important for you to try to be there to make our efforts, you know, make the efforts the best they can be for this project. So photo-only surveys are recommended. You don't need a permit if you're not handling the bee, so taking pictures is fine. And we get data from that. And then surveying areas, you're going to want to survey many areas rather than repeating sampling in one so that you can see where it is. But you should prioritize the best habitat because these species are, for this type of monitoring where we do the bee blitz, this species is really wanting the high quality stuff. So definitely put your emphasis on that. But sample large areas too if you can. All right, so that leads me to the next part of this workshop. Probably we'll have more than 30 minutes outside, so that'll be great. You can submit your photos to Bee Spotter. There's also something called Bumblebee Watch, and that's a really great site too, similar, but I'm going to walk you through this specific one because they're going to help us. They're like our partners in the project. And I'm a TU of I, so I understand their system, and the people there are really great. The database, the people there are really great in identification, but the database is really easy, is really user-friendly. So even if you're not that comfortable with pictures and uploading and databases, I'm going to walk you through the whole thing. So by the time you're taking your own pictures and you're ready to submit, you'll at least be comfortable enough and know how to go through and do this on your own. But Andres will tell you more about it. He's offered to help you too. So don't feel like you're out of the project now because you don't want to do it, because he's here to offer assistance to you. So only good photographs that show the key characteristics can be verified. So if you, another tip is if you note the flower that the bumblebee is using, sometimes that can help in identification, but it's not necessarily needed. The photographic documentation of Bombus affinis is required to verify the record. So even if I go out and see one and I told them, oh, I saw this, we'd still have to go back and get the picture to identify the species. It can't just be hearsay. And you don't need a specimen either. This is an endangered species, so photos are awesome. It's a good middle ground. So a little bit about BeeSpotter. When you go into the website, like BeeSpotter, Google, enter, you have this top bar here has home, topics, find the bees, submit the spottings, a little bit about, and then the name. So you guys can make one that's for your bee blitz if you wanted, and have like a whole name and username that everybody uses. And you can enter your username to get in here, and then you'll go to submit spottings. So I'm going to talk about how to submit your spotting. Sorry, my time's going slow today. I need to wake up. There's also topics on home, and then an actual topic on topics where you can go there and click and read different stories about bees. And there's this funny article about May Barenbaum and how she like hid an insect under her bed, and like all these fun, interesting things that are directed to bees that the University of Illinois found acceptable to put there. And then you can find different bees. So if you want to see where the Bombus and Patience are in your area, you can click it and see on the map where they are. If you wanted to see where the Rusty Patch Bumblebee has been spotted, the rough areas are also here. Then you can submit your spottings. So this is a great database to just learn a little bit more about bumblebees. But the primary reason I'm showing you it today is because this is the database you're going to submit your photos through. So when you go to submit spottings, does everyone see that up there? Submit spottings, you'll click that, and then that's where you're going to put your photos. So if you use your username and password that the DuPage County is using, you can title your spotting here something specific to who you are, maybe. Like Brittany's spotting, and then I think we're all going to be in the same area, right? Mm-hmm. So maybe we'll reference that area and all the titles with your name, something like that. Of course, there'll be more details for you the day of the event. And then one important thing to note for this date. Let's say you take your camera home and you want to relax for a few days, and then when you're more refreshed, you come back and you want to submit your photos later. Don't put the date that you that you're submitting the photo. Put the date that you took the photo. Because let's say you accidentally forget and it's December and you're like, oh, I wanted to put that data in there, and you say you found, you know, this bee in December, we're going to know that's not right. And like I told you with the queens, vegans, and bombus, affinis, one of the details for species identification can be the date the queen's flying around. So it can be really important. Just make a mental note that that's not the day you're submitting. And you're phone will usually keep that date with the pictures that you took, too. Then it'll ask you for your location, so you'll just type in the location that you found it. It doesn't need to be the exact GPS coordinate. It can be the area, the address. And then finally, you will upload the photo. So how many of you have a smartphone that has access to the internet and able to take photos? So this is the easy part about that. You literally just click choose photo file, and then you click the picture on your phone and it goes straight there. You can do it different ways. You can send it to Andres. He's offered to help and he can do it for you. You can use a normal camera and plug it into your computer, you know, take the photos from your camera to your computer, from the computer to here. It's just an extra step, but it works too, especially if you're not as comfortable with the iPhone or the smartphone and you're more comfortable with your camera, then I would advise you go ahead and use your camera, whatever you're most comfortable with. It just takes a bit longer to transfer, but that's fine. Whatever you feel more comfortable with. One other thing to note is, and I will touch on it later, just to tell you now, if you see one bee, you can take more than one picture of one bee. So the first bee you see, you take three pictures. Then you're going to want to take a picture of something that's not a bee, like your hand or the sky or something, so that you know the next bee picture, even if it's the same species, is not the same bee, because that will be a data. So that's called a spacer or a blank spot. And then for submission purposes, each bee gets their own submission. So So if you have 7 bees, you're going to go through this 7 times and have to put the location in 7 times. So it's not that tedious. You just have to title each bee as a different name. So not each picture, but each bee is a different submission. Because you're going to get an identification confirmation per bee. So all the pictures will stay together. And then, since you've taken this course, since you're here in this workshop, if you have an idea of what it is, let's say you know it's bombus impatiens, how would you know that? The first figure is completely yellow, everything else red, is black, and it's a common bee in the area, so you're like, okay, this is probably bombus impatiens. So you go here, and you can click it in its color pattern, and that will help save a little bit of time on bee spotter's end. That would be really helpful. So if you can't do that, or if you don't want to do it, don't worry about it. This is just helping. It's not to say that's what this is what I think it is, and they'll either confirm it or deny it later. So here is our location again, but this is through Bee Spotter. So these are all the species. Here's where you can tell that it's all the species of bees. So someone around here is using Bee Spotter already. See all these sightings of bees from the area, so that's kind of exciting. So once you put your data on here, you'll be able to see it'll increase. So this is obviously good habitat for bumblebees, looking at this map. And then here are the rusty patch bumblebees spottings from Bee Spotter. So that's kind of exciting, right? Pretty close. Do you know where that is? Is it somewhere?
It's right down the road.
Springbrook, that's what it says on that bottom one.
St. James Farm?
St. James Farm.
So it's around the area, you know, and this habitat's really great. So that's the exciting part. That's why I'm suggesting to get you to monitor long term, to keep your eye on.
Illinois.
You're gonna have to look. I'm so sorry. I should know that. I don't know. So it's not just Illinois for Bee Spotter. There's other states too.
Okay.
Okay, so another thing to know, I think I already mentioned it, is at least one photo of a bee would be great. If there's only one, that's great, but it's hard to sometimes get that identifiable feature in a clear shot. So take multiple photos if you want. Another thing to be aware of is you can take a video of a bee flying around and then pull pictures out of the video. So raise your hand if you know how to do that. Okay, well if you don't, these people will help you do it because it's relatively easy. You can shoot the video and then when you go back you can move the box, if you have an iPhone, over each frame and maybe you'll get an identifiable photo out of that frame. So that could be another way to do it.
Well, and then you can screenshot.
It gets you less pressure of making it clear and you can do a separate submission for each of the bees. So this one is a perfect example. See, you have the back abdomen, the tour guides, there's a side view, even a facial view. But what's one thing about this specific bee? It's on a pin, so of course they're going to get the perfect picture. It's a little bit more difficult out in the field when you're feeling hot and you have to be quick because some of these bees are so fast. Some of them are going to take their time and, you know, sip their nectar in front of you, do a pose. Other ones are going to take them around, zip around. So be quick. So identifiable photos, you need to record where, when, and by whom the photo is taken. So even if all of you are using the DuPage account, you can still title it with your name or make some way of knowing who the photographer is so then you can go back and know which photo is yours. Flower species may help for the identification, at least provide the county. And again, it's the day that you took the picture and not the day that you submitted the photo. And what do you notice about this rusty patch?
Is that a rusty patch?
It's a queen.
Mm-hmm. So we've been seeing the other color patterns. This is the one that's a little bit less in your face.
How do you know that's a rusty patch?
Please.
So you see on your identification guide how there's different patterns for different species. This is the one pattern of the rusty path bumblebee species that doesn't have the pattern on it. Mm-hmm. And it's the hair is different than the vegans, right?
Okay.
I think probably this picture and this picture went together, so you can see the tuft there. That's probably half. So which bees to photograph? The honeybee and the bumblebee are accepted on Bee Spotter. And you can check out what is and isn't a bee. There's a couple of robber flies. Is anybody aware of them that look exactly like bumblebees?
Yeah.
And they fly a little bit like bumblebees. Those are so awesome. But we're not interested in those. There's some moths that look like bumblebees. Anybody seen those? The clear beans moths? Yeah, so those are pretty tricky sometimes too. But now that we've gone through the identification guide and you've seen so many pictures, you'll probably be able to identify what's a bumblebee. How to take a good picture of a bee. You need to get good focus and have it be well lit. And then you want the bee to be the large part of the photograph. So have you noticed on all the pictures that I've showed you, it's pretty much just like zoomed up on the bee. It's not like the bee is somewhere in the landscape. So if you wanted to go home and crop your pictures to make the bee bigger, you can, but it's not necessarily needed. Like if it's between you doing that and not uploading it, go ahead and upload. But these are the ones that are preferred, that are zoomed in on the identifiable characteristics of each bee. So this one is viewed in the dorsal aspect, the entire upper side of the bee. It's preferably with the bee's wings open rather than closed so that you can see that really important turgite 1 and turgite 2. Because sometimes when I've been there before waiting for the bee and she has her wings rested right on her back and it takes her a really long time to open the wings, and sometimes that's needed for the species. So be patient sometimes when the wings are covering that important part. You can show the upper side of the abdomen, of the body, especially the abdomen. And you can take pictures of the same bee from different angles. But again, like it's a little bit different when I say this sitting here and then when you go into the field and this thing is really fast, and depending on what she's eating, she can move out really, really quick. You have to practice a little bit before you're gonna get comfortable, but I feel like everyone in here will be able to do it with some practice. Stationary bees are way easier to photograph than the bees that are in flight. So if a bee, this is always the example, like usually to kids, but I'll say it here too. Imagine that you are in your house with your family and all of the things that you've worked hard for, and someone comes into your nest and is like messing with things, pulling out your family of the house, putting them back in. You know, if you go to the nest of the bee, they're probably going to attack you because genetically speaking, they've invested in their offspring. So they will die, they'll sting you to protect the family at home in the nest. So for example, when I found that colony underground, I wanted to identify it, and I was a few feet away, the fervidus. They wanted me away from the nest to protect their family, to protect their resources. If the same exact bee is out foraging, nectar collecting pollen out in the field, she is probably not going to leave her meal to come and attack you, biologically and genetically speaking, because then she dies, and it's usually just for herself, so there's no real genetic push to sting people if you're just foraging. So you can really get comfortable and close to these bees. If they do get annoyed, which they might, they are really interested in neon clothing. So you guys with the bright green shirts, they will come up to you and literally think you're a huge flower, or potentially could be, something to check out. And has anyone ever seen a bee like kind of hover in front of them and look at them? It's weird, like they'll look at your face. They're trying to investigate if you're edible or not. So they'll figure it out and usually go away, but sometimes people get really stressed out about that, and start flurrying their hands or freaking out, and that gives the bee, some reinforcement that you are a threat and that her behavior should be aggressive. So if you're uncomfortable with the bee looking at you, just kind of walk away or move away, and she'll usually leave you alone. If she's annoyed or upset or mad, bees generally dive bomb. So they will hit your head, and that means, okay, you need to go. So you did something, or she has a feeling a certain way about something, and you know, she's just asking you to leave. So at that point, walk away, and she should be fine. If the bee follows you, which would be really rare, but if it does, you can run 15 miles per hour and outbeat it, so. Don't hide in the river, that would be it. So these bees, on Bee Spotter, they said, approach the subject with confidence, common sense, and reasonable caution, but not fear. And I definitely agree with that, so I put it word for word what they're saying. You need to have respect for the animal, but don't be scared that she's going to leave and sting you, because genetically speaking, it just doesn't make sense for her to do it. I mean, we've all been in a situation or heard of a situation where a bee like gets in your clothes, or you step on it, or it's in your soda. So if you come in contact with it accidentally, it would probably sting you in defense, but otherwise it won't leave. Like the one that you're looking at to take a photo probably won't leave to get you. So don't be too scared about stings. So don't reduce the entire size of the photo. Instead, crop the full-size photo to include only the bee, and if a flower is there, the flower is nice to have too for certain species identification. So I'm going to show you an example. See how it's the same photo, but the bees are easier to identify in the one on the left. So who wants to raise their hand and identify this bee? Yeah. Good job. How did you know?
The shiny bum.
Yeah, see the shiny abdomen? This one is not a bumblebee, right? So I thought I would trick you, but you were catching on. So this is a huge carpenter bee. Isn't it gigantic? And the abdomen is completely bald, so we know it's not a honeybee or a bumblebee. All right, so what we're going to do, we have about 45 minutes now. So we will use the ID that we have, ID guides that I gave you. We'll go out into, Andres will lead us wherever he wants to take us. We'll take our phones. Who has a phone with them today that can take photos? If you don't, pair up with someone that does. It'll be a good experience. So take the photo of your hand in between the bees, right? Or a photo in between the specimens, because each one needs to be identified as an individual. And then we'll practice using these guides. So I got my pictures and information from the website, the U.S. Fish and Wildlife website. Definitely go and check it out if you have any interest in any of the information I've given you. And you can check out some information on Bee Spotter. BugGuide.net. Does anyone know about BugGuide.net? It's for other species of insects and invertebrates. It's really cool. You can take a photo and upload it there, and they'll identify a species for you. And you can go there and do it the other way too, and use the photos to identify what you have. It's free. So thank you for your time. I'm looking forward to investigating what's out here in the front.